Well, when Pope Benedict asked Giotto for a drawing to prove his worth as an artist, Giotto drew a perfect circle. Freehand. Perfection. It's a powerful message.
Powerful message.
Powerful message.
I'm a single white male, 32 years old, and I've never been too great with the women. Well, if the truth's being told, I'm not much good with people. I've been alone in all the places I lived in. But fated forgiven my shortcomings and brought something forth from inside me that guides me when a call comes in. It's as if I'm blessed with a gift to talk someone into a spell unknown when I'm lecturing with the telephone before it's running. Face to face a hella hard, I'm afraid to date, but somehow make a great telemarketer. Cause I could sell Antarctica ice in wintertime with 29 inches that won't melt and mark up the price. Might be the fact I'm alone, but most of the human contact that I've known I've always had through the phone. So when I get back to the home where I live now, I sit down and dial my old map to see who answers the half of the old ones. I get the message.
The number you have reached has been disconnected.
With 10 digits entered from another past number, the ringing interrupts a man's slumber. And that was just from last summer. The change is enormous, and keeping up to speed's a real game of endurance. I always get some lame little office specializing in claims for insurance, or maybe the occasional florist.
Corner florist.
Hello?
Hello?
I'm sorry, what did you say?
Corner florist.
Is this a flower shop?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry, I think I have the wrong number.
Okay, bye.
Why am I still searching? And for what I don't know, perhaps a real person or some version of love on the phone. It's like these 10 little buttons have grown so significant. My will's worthless fighting off the gluttonous Jones. So I chose a different number to try, and I was thinking I'd end up ringing another old guy. But when I reached the third line, what a surprise. It was the first time in my whole life on a telephone my tongue was so tied.
Hello? Hello? Is there somebody there? I can hear you.
It must have been something we shared in the weird few moments of rare silence when I was quiet like no one was there. So unprepared to ever get your voice. I fell in love though I was scared like I was left no choice. But you can expect most boys who get a first taste of love in their 30s to revert to their 7th birthday. That's probably why I went the worst way and devised a plan to get to know her with my voice disguised and invented surveys.
Hello?
Hi, I'm calling from the census department. I was hoping you could answer a few questions of ours, ma'am.
Yeah, sure.
How many people live in your apartment? What are their ages? And by chance, is anyone partner?
Well, it's just me. I'm 30 and I'm not married.
Alrighty. Do you move often and have your jobs vary?
No, I've been here for the last 3 years. And my jobs, did you say?
Yes, ma'am. How many past careers?
Well, I'm not really a people person. I've always worked in a lab.
Ma'am, I don't blame you with all the jerks that we have. I take it you don't get out much to flirt with the lads.
Are you kidding?
It's just as well. Men are perfectly crabbed.
Working the plans I had sown to build a rapport, I realized to have her by phone wouldn't fulfill me no more. So using the skills I was born with, I got an address at home, killing the call so I could see the best match that I've known. Perhaps it was only a sad attempt to find the nerve it would take to say goodbye to the phone and tell the girl to her face.
Well, I won't put your day further to waste. Thanks for your time, ma'am. Sorry to disturb you, okay? Bye.
Okay, bye.
Times call for closer measures, so I left behind the telephone and bought some telephoto lenses. Parked in a car like those old detectives I watched from afar, and saw that she lived by herself, alone and friendless. Then what I noticed next would leave me livid. Her only guest was a handsome guy whose weekly visits had a cry. By the time he would leave, I bet the guy was an ex or current flame, unless my eyes were deceived. I tried to believe, she cried to relieve heartache, but the sky wouldn't leave. It seems she was liable to be in harm's way. If I could just sneak in her place, I'd find it would lead to a trace of why she would keep letting this creep within arm's length. Getting the peace was the easy part, cause if by chance I met him when I crept in through the window, I would need the arms. I was breathing hard when I stepped in, broke the glass and the shards with the weapon, and tore the bedroom where she sleeps apart. That's when a creaking part of the floor and the twisting knob on the door startled me. I turned with the gun and shot it before I realized I killed my own love. I dropped on all fours, sobbing and coughing till I spilled my own guts. I came to, still on the rug in the same room, filled with the stuff I had tossed around. And then I found in plain view what seemed to be a diary. sitting beside my knee. I couldn't make my mind believe the words that I would finally read. Page one.
Thursday, 5:03. I was trying to sleep before the night shift when this guy woke me. He had a voice that had a vibe so sweet. It was caught in my thoughts and just wouldn't let my mind go free.
I skipped to page 74 and read a bit more.
The only thing that I look forward to is getting his calls. If only I could get up the gall, I would tell him I love
him. I had to skip right to the end of it all.
As for the last passage, it began. Why me? Where's my mystery man? God, how could you let this guy leave? With all the bad times and depression I've seen, this just has to be the last life's lesson I need. In fact, this week's visit with my little brother, he said if the cancer keeps getting worse, it'll kill our mother. He said the doc said I should just accept that she's dying. And from the second he left, I spent the rest of the week crying.
Recording.